Good afternoon. Let's get started. My pleasure to actually welcome Dr. RONNY HADANI from Cohere Technologies. I actually met RONNY about perhaps a year ago. I've spent a lot of time on this topic with him, at least 10 hours, going through all kinds of issues. He has turned me from what I would call a skeptic to, I won't say still yet a believer. I think there are a lot of things which I still need to understand. But I think, clearly the scheme that he has come up with, OTFS, is, and he will explain what OTFS is definitely worthy of serious investigation by researchers and by in academia as well as in the industry to see where this can go. Will it have the ability to play to replace OFDM is an interesting question, and time and will decide that, and the amount of work that the industry puts into it will decide that. RONNY actually comes with a very interesting background. He is a mathematician by training, working on representation theory. I think that's his background. And from there, he, I'm not exactly sure when you started. And again, I hope people actually talk about it, why you started looking at this problem, but ended up actually looking at this problem and working with the CEO of his company to raise lots and lots of money and actually take it a lot further. And they have done a very credible job. So, we are all used to thinking about, for those of you who are learning, who's learning wireless communications, we model the channel by means of, a bunch of reflectors that will essentially introduce some amount of multipath. The signal scatters, the transmitted signal scatters from these channels, from these reflectors. And if you have mobility, then you essentially have some Doppler shifts associated with each of these reflectors and resulting in Doppler spread. So overall, you have a multipath delay Doppler spread channel. And we essentially stop at that point, and then either we use traditional single carrier modulations, which we did at GSM, CDMA, essentially single carrier but spread in spread spectrum, and then you the latest technologies of pretty much all forms of wireless is using OFDM, I think RONNY has come up with a very, very nice way to look at how do we essentially localize signals in both delay and then Doppler, and has come up with signal representation that takes natural advantage of that. So I think it's a very, very interesting formulation, and we'll looking forward to hearing about all of that. Thank you.
Thanks, Nambi. It's a pleasure to be here. Just to answer your question, how did I got introduced to all of this? So it's a funny story. My father-in-law is a professor of electrical engineering. He, Boaz Porat, is from the Technion, delayed Boaz Porat. And for years I didn't have anything to talk with him, and he is my father-in-law. over many dinners of Saturday dinners, eventually I start to realize that signal processing is something which have some interface with the field of mass that I'm working in, and this was in the beginning of 2000. So I knew there is a link between representation theory and signal processing, but then you need to you have other worries if you want to develop an academic career, and I forgot all about it. And in 2009 I met Shlomo Rakib, who is the founder, my co-founder of Cohere. And we met in San Francisco. I was in a conference, and I met him. I think I gave a lecture in his previous company, and then we decided to work together to see if we clicked. He got interested in what I was talking about, and he said, "Let's try to do something together." And we had several Skype conversations over a period of few months, and look and behold, miracle happened. And at the end of these 6 or 7 months, we had a patent, and this was the beginning of OTFS. Just to give you an idea of the level of ignorance that I had about communication when I began this journey, I didn't know what is a DB. Just basically, it was just beyond my grasp. Why do you have to take log 10 and then multiply by 10? It was very difficult for me to understand that. Today I know what is a DB. So that's the general story. So I come from a very stern field. So really, all this project, as I told you, started 9 years ago with an abstract mathematical concept from representation theory. So you see the formula, that's OTFS. This is what you see on the left. You see the ZAC transform, you see twisted convolution. So this is really this formula captures or amounts to a very interesting waveform for general communication, but in particular adapted to wireless. And really over a period of 8 or 9 years, with the help of many talented engineers and other professionals, we converted this abstract formula into a real technology, which is a radio system which implement this waveform and can deliver very high throughput in challenging environments. So it took us 9 years. And on the academic side, so the first, we only started to publish material about OTFS around a year and a half ago. So there was a conference paper and then a few other conference papers. And it's very gratifying to see there is a growing amount of activity in the academia around OTFS. So the last I counted, there are more than 20 or 30 publications about OTFS from various different universities. I just saw a publication by Gerard Fettwive about OTFS. So distinguished people thinking about it, expanding upon the theory and the applications. And for me personally, it's very gratifying. And you see the theory is building up, and it's a good time to join this festival because it's really a new ground and uncharted territory. And I gave you a link here below that you can go. There are very, I think, good presentations that summarize much of the publications, the material that you can find on the web about OTFS. So this is the structure of my lecture. I will probably focus only on the first point and I will glimpse on the others, but I'm going to talk about the science about OTFS. I want to define for you what OTFS is. After this lecture, everybody in this room will know exactly what OTFS is, what is the physics behind it, what is the mathematical structure behind it, and then you can do whatever you want with this knowledge. I will talk a little bit about delay-Doppler channel modeling. I will talk about delay-Doppler precoding in application with MU-MIMO. And then about OTFS propagation attributes, what makes this waveform so unique. We'll talk a little bit about resilience to interference, resilience to Doppler spread, and maybe a little bit about link budget as well. So let me start about the overview of OTFS. So really OTFS is part of a larger theory of doing communication in a domain called the delay Doppler domain. So you know about time and frequency because this is the domain which is multicarrier modulations are defined over. So we are going to introduce another domain, which is called the delay Doppler domain. And there are two aspects to this theory. The first aspect is modeling the wireless channel in the delay Doppler domain. This is called the delay Doppler channel model. And once you do that, you reduce the channel dimensionality by many orders of magnitude. Literally, the dimension of the channel, the number of parameters that you need in order to represent the channel is something like 15 dominant reflectors. And this is independent of the MIMO order. So this is a very important thing. And once the dimensionality is reduced so much, you can process the channel in a very efficient manner. In particular, you can predict it dozens and hundreds of milliseconds into the future. You can predict it also in frequency, hundreds of megahertz into adjacent bands. And this allows operating in TDD and FDD MU-MIMO. It also allows cloud run, because when you do cloud run, where all the processing is done in a processing unit which is very distant from the base station, you need to create enough latency to combat channel aging. So you really need a good representation of the channel, and you really need to understand the physics of the channel and how to process it and learn it in the right way. And then you can sense the channel in a very efficient manner. If you have such a low dimensional representation, you can literally spend very few parameters in sensing the channel over the full band. And you can actually sense thousands of channels with very minimal overhead in terms of your total capacity. So that's the first aspect. And then there is the second aspect, which is complementary, which says, well, if the correct representation of the channel is the delay Doppler coordinates, why not to place the information itself in the same coordinate system? This is modulation. And turns out there is a mathematically meaningful way to do it, and this is the OTFS modulation. Placing the QAM symbols in the delay Doppler coordinate system where the channel looks so nice and compact. And once you do that, you have a complete communication system based on delay Doppler formalism. You represent the channel in delay Doppler, you place the information in delay Doppler in a way which interact with the delay Doppler channel model, and in this way, you can reap all the benefits of the delay Doppler coordinates for a communication system, and you can scale. You can scale the capacity, you can scale the complexity, and you get superior propagation attributes. And this is really the kind of communication system that Cohere envisions. So I will start with OTFS. In fact, I will focus about OTFS because this is really the core innovation here. So where does the OTFS waveform fit in the general framework of wireless? How do you invent a new waveform at all, yes? So you have to start with the three basic waveforms. So you have TDMA, which is based on pulses which are localized in time. You have OFDM, which is tones, but in fact tones are pulses which are localized in frequency, which are converted to time using the Fourier transform, so they look like tones. So really OFDM is pulses in frequency. And then you have CDMA, which is a kind of a complete mess. You just spread. You spread both in time and in frequency. Now, each one of these waveforms is interesting, have specific attributes which are beneficial. For example, the pulse gives you low PAPR. The tone gives you this decoupling of the channel. And spread spectrum gives you resilience to narrowband interference. Now, every time you trade one of these waveforms for another, you are trading one set of good properties for another set of good properties. So in fact, what you want to do, you don't want to trade, but you want to combine this waveform together in a way that will bring together all the benefits. But you cannot just teach them in an arbitrary fashion, because then you are going to lose all the physics. These waveforms have physical meaning. So you need to teach them in a mathematically meaningful way, and here comes the interesting news. There is a way to do that. In fact, these three waveforms are mathematical descendants of a single mother waveform, which simultaneously localized in time like TDMA, localized in frequency like OFDM, and spread spectrum like CDMA, and it combines all the benefits. And this is called OTFS. And let me show you how this waveform looks like, and then I'm going to explain the math or the science or the structure behind the picture that you see. This is how the OTFS waveform looks like. This is an OTFS carrier. Okay, a single QAM is carried over this waveform. It's a sequence of pulses, evenly spaced in time, and each pulse is multiplied by a complex phase, and the phases are rotating in the IQ plane according to a specific frequency. So if you wish, it's a tone modulated over a pulse train. Okay? Now this is a very interesting waveform because locally it looks like a pulse and behaves like one. Globally it looks like a tone and it behaves like one. And in addition, it is spread spectrum in the appropriate sense. And what makes this waveform unique is that it is invariant under the operations of time delay and Doppler shift. What do I mean by that? If you take this waveform and you shift it in time, it preserves its shape. If you shift it in frequency, it preserves its shape. If you take this waveform and you apply Fourier transform to it, guess what? You get the same waveform. It is Fourier dual to itself. It's a very symmetric waveform. This is the symmetry. This is where representation theory comes in. Now, why this invariance is important?
Quick question, Ronnie. What is the spacing between the pulses?
I will talk about it. So why invariance is important? Because this means that if you transmit this waveform through a wireless channel, an arbitrary wireless channel, well, the channel consists of reflectors, and every reflector introduces a distortion, which is a combination of time delay and Doppler shift. But if your waveform is invariant under the operations of time delay and Doppler shift, it means that what you receive is a very predictable consequence of what you transmitted. It's like a sphere that you can rotate, but the sphere is invariant under rotation. So this is a kind of a sphere with respect to time delay and Doppler shift. So when this waveform interacts with the channel, it looks like you are driving a car with good suspensions. It's like the road might be very, very bumpy, but you don't feel the bumps because the car somehow is oblivious to the bumps. That's the symmetry thing. And this directly translates to performance consistency and robustness. This is really the intuition. I didn't say anything formal yet. But this is just to distill in your brain something that, okay, that's what you need to have in mind when we talk about OTFS. All right, so now the math. I want to really explain to you the mathematics behind it. So really, if you want to understand OTFS from first principles, I need to take you back, you need to go back to the foundations, and we need to go back to signal processing 101, okay, to the foundations of signal processing. And what they teach you in signal processing 101, they talk about time and frequency, all right? So if you have a signal, you can either represent it as a function of time, or you can represent it as a function of frequency, and these two representations are interchangeable by means of the Fourier transform. That's what they teach you, all right? If you forget everything else, that's what you remember. But time and frequency are peculiar. Well, they do not behave like orthogonal dimension, in the sense that if you have a signal which is localized in time, when you convert it to frequency, it is not localized in frequency. And vice versa, if you have a signal which is localized in frequency, it is not localized in time. This is called the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. You cannot really put your finger in a specific point of time frequency. If you are localized in one, you are smeared in the other. Okay, that's a fundamental obstruction. All right, you cannot localize simultaneously. If you could, then signal processing will become a trivial theory. It will basically become like planar geometry, and all the problems will be trivially solved. So what makes signal processing an interesting topic to study is this obstruction, is the Heisenberg uncertainty principle. You have to dance around it. That's the whole difficulty of harmonic analysis. And here comes the math, or the mathematical insight. Turns out that if you dig deeper into the math behind time and frequency, you realize that they admit a more subtle form of orthogonality. Namely, there are specific type of signals which obey the Heisenberg uncertainty principle, but they behave as if they don't. Namely, these signals correspond to two-dimensional pulses, but these pulses are not localized in time and frequency in the naive sense. They are localized in a more sophisticated sense. They are localized up to something called quasi-periodicity. I will explain that. And these pulses, you should think about them as signals in a different signal representation called the delay-Doppler representation, which I'm going to explain next. So you should think about these as localized in this delay-Doppler representation. So what is a signal in the delay-Doppler representation? It's a function of two variables. One is called delay, and the other is called Doppler. All right, so it's a two-dimensional signal. Now, these variables are known to people in communication theory because you are typically using them to parameterize the wireless channel. This is called the delay-Doppler representation of the channel. Every tap in this representation represents a cluster of reflectors of specific delay characteristic, namely range, and specific Doppler characteristic, namely velocity. And that's the most meaningful representation of the channel, and also the sparsest representation of the channel. So this is known, all right? What is less known is that you can use the same variables, delay Doppler, to parameterize signals or waveforms. And waveforms are very different objects than channels. Channels operate on waveforms, okay? So how do you represent a waveform in the delay Doppler coordinates? To do that, you need to fix two parameters. You need to fix a period along delay and a period along Doppler, and these two periods define a box of area one. That's the only condition. Now, you can choose these variables any way you want, but you choose them once, and you put it on the shelf, and you don't touch it anymore, because these are the parameters of the theory. Okay? So once you choose these parameters, you can talk about a delay Doppler signal. Well, it's a function of delay Doppler which satisfies a property called quasi-periodicity. What does it mean? It means that it's a function that if you start from a specific value and you move a period along delay, you end up with the same value rotated by a phase. And the phase, by the way, depends on the Doppler. You move another period, another phase. And the same thing if you move a period along Doppler. You rotate by a phase, which depends on delay. And these are the formulas. So if you wish, roughly speaking, it means that you are periodic up to phase rotation. Okay? So let me show you an example. Let's build a quasi-periodic pulse, which in fact is going to be very important for us. So you start with an arbitrary pulse. In order to make it a delay Doppler signal or a quasi-periodic signal, you need to extend it to an infinite configuration of pulses. This goes to infinity. And every time you shift a period, you rotate by a phase. And this is the way I represent phase rotation. All right? Peculiar stuff. And why do I bother you with this strange definition of quasi-periodicity? Well, because of the following very important reason. Turns out that the Heisenberg uncertainty principle does not forbid you from localizing in time and frequency to any desired degree as long as you extend quasi-periodically. I will say it again, this is very important. The Heisenberg uncertainty principle does not forbid you from localizing to any desired degree as long as you extend quasi-periodically. This means that in the confinement of this fundamental box, you can be as localized as you want, as long as you extend quasi-periodically. And this means that if the delay spread and the Doppler spread of the channel are smaller than these periods, you behave indistinguishably from a truly localized signal, because you can never interact with your aliases. So to any practical purpose, such a quasi-periodic signal behave indistinguishably from a truly non-existent localized signals both in time and in frequency. Okay? And this quasi-periodic pulse, that's the carrier, that's the tone of OTFS. It's an object, it's a signal, which behaves indistinguishably from something which is localized both in time and in frequency. And we are going to see this from different angles as we proceed. So this is a summary of signal processing as it should be taught in the 21st century. You have three basic signal representations. You have time, you have frequency, related by Fourier transform, and you have another signal representation called delay Doppler, where signals are represented by quasi-periodic functions in delay Doppler. And these three representations are interchangeable by means of canonical transforms. You have the Fourier transform, and then you have two transforms converting from delay Doppler to time and frequency, and they have a name. They are called the Zach transforms. And they have very simple structure. Going from delay Doppler to time means basically integrating along Doppler. Going from delay Doppler to frequency, you integrate along delay, you project. All right, and these form an equivalence. Okay, if you look at this diagram, this face of the diagram is OFDM. OFDM place the QAM information symbols along the frequency domain, or a grid in the frequency domain, and modulate them using the Fourier transform into a transmitted waveform. And this face of the diagram is OTFS. OTFS place the QAM information symbols along a grid in delay Doppler and modulate them using the Zach transform. Now, there is another interesting thing about this diagram, which mathematicians called commutativity. Namely, doesn't matter how you travel along the circumference, you end up with the same result. In particular, the Fourier transform is the composition of the two Zach transforms. So instead of going from frequency to time in one step, you can first go from frequency to delay Doppler using ZF inverse, and then from delay Doppler to time using ZT, and you will get exactly the same result. And here I can ask you a question. This means that you have two different algorithms to implement the Fourier transform. You have the direct algorithm, just implementing the Fourier transform, and you have this two-step algorithm, implementing it through two Zach transforms. And I can ask you the following question. Do you recognize the two-step algorithm from your curriculum? And the answer is that you should, because that's the FFT algorithm. That's the Cooley-Tookie algorithm, without knowing that, by the way. So in fact, the fast Fourier transform algorithm is decomposing the Fourier transform into two ZAC transforms. In fact, every time you're computing the FFT, what you're doing, instead of going from frequency to time, you go from frequency to quasi-periodic world in delay Doppler, and then from this quasi-periodic world back to time. That's what you're doing without knowing that. So it's already present in this fundamental algorithm. All right? And what OTFS is doing is sitting in the middle. Between the wings of the Cooley-Tookie, yes? You just put your information in this intermediate world, all right? Really. In particular, you understand that the complexity of OTFS is half the complexity of OFDM, because you are using only half of the FFT algorithm to modulate your information. All right. So this is how the OTFS carrier looks like. It's a quasi-periodic pulse in delay Doppler. That's what carries your information, all right? So how do you transmit this pulse? You have to convert it to time using the ZAC transform. And after you convert it to time using the ZAC transform, guess what you are going to get? That's what you're going to get. So this is how a pulse in delay Doppler looks like when you convert it to time. It's a tone modulated over a pulse train. That's the time realization of a nice two-dimensional pulse in the delay Doppler representation. And let me elaborate on the relation between these two signals. All right? This is an analogy to OFDM that a tone is the time realization of a pulse in frequency. All right? So let me elaborate. The delay coordinate of the two-dimensional pulse specify the time displacement of the pulse train. As you shift the two-dimensional pulse along delay, the pulse train is shifting in a TDMA fashion. The Doppler coordinate of the pulse specify the frequency of the tone. So as you shift the pulse along Doppler, the tone is oscillating in different frequencies in an OFDM fashion. Okay? By the way, what happens if you take this two-dimensional pulse and you shift it a complete period? The pulse train is shifting, and what happens after you complete a period? It coincides with itself, but with a different phase. That's quasi-periodicity. You don't return to the same shape. You return to the same shape up to a phase rotation. You cannot get rid of that. All right? Let me elaborate further. The width of this pulse along delay is inversely proportional to the bandwidth. So if you want to make this two-dimensional pulse narrower and narrower along delay, you need to expand your transmission over a wider and wider bandwidth. Okay? The width of this pulse along Doppler is inversely proportional to the duration of the pulse train. As you want to make this pulse narrower and narrower along Doppler, it means that you need to expand your pulse train over a longer and longer duration, observation time. Now, this is interesting because it means that if you want to be localized in delay Doppler, it means that you need to be spread in conventional time and frequency. This is what people in radar theory say call compressed locality. You look local in delay Doppler, but in conventional time, you are actually spread. But as you are going to see, you will behave as if you are truly localized. Okay? Let me tell you something else very, very quickly. How you should think about this two-dimensional pulse? You should think about it as a delay Doppler filter. All right? What you start with is a delta function in delay Doppler. In fact, a quasi-periodic delta function in delay Doppler. That's the digital carrier of OTFS. And then you want to convert this digital carrier into a physical carrier. You need to apply a filter to it. And in this delay Doppler signal processing, application of a filter is done by means of something called quasi-convolution with a filter, which is this two-dimensional pulse. And once you apply this operation, you get a physical pulse. And on the upper part of this picture, you see the time realization of this operation. a delta function in delay Doppler correspond to phase modulated delta pulse train, and then delay Doppler filtering correspond to shaping this pulse train both in time and in frequency. So quasi-periodic with a quasi-convolution with a two-dimensional pulse in delay Doppler correspond to simultaneously shaping your transmission both in time and in frequency. Okay? So this is really the beginning of delay Doppler signal processing. How do you do signal processing in delay Doppler? That's part of what you need to teach yourself if you want to do delay Doppler communication. You need to learn how to apply filters to signals in delay Doppler. Okay, so I told you everything you need to know about OTFS basically, because from this point on, you can treat OTFS like any other orthogonal modulation. If you want to transmit a packet of information, you place a grid in delay Doppler, you position a pulse over each one of these grid points, you multiply every one of these pulses by a Qualcomm symbol, in this case, N Qualcomm symbols along delay, M Qualcomm symbols along Doppler, you get this configuration and you transmit it using the ZAC transform. The same way that you do with OFDM, but there you put the pulses along a grid in frequency and you transmit using the Fourier transform. Now let me give you some numerology, some specific numerology that you have numbers in mind. And you will see that we are not breaking the Nyquist rate, for example, that everything is aligned with what you know about signal processing. So typical delay period is 50 microseconds, okay? Typical delay resolution, which means the width of the pulse along delay, is 100 nanoseconds. So this means that you have 500 points along delay. Now, 100 nanoseconds, 1 over 100 nanoseconds is 10 megahertz. And I told you, that's the bandwidth of your transmission. 1 over the width of your pulse. So the bandwidth is 10 megahertz. A typical Doppler period is 20 kilohertz, which is 1 over 50 microseconds. And a typical Doppler resolution, which is the width of the pulse along Doppler, is 1 kilohertz. So overall, you have 20 points along the Doppler period. Now, 1 kilohertz, 1 over 1 kilohertz is 1 millisecond, which means that the duration of your transmission is 1 over the width of the pulse along Doppler, which is 1 millisecond. Overall, you are transmitting 500 times 20 grid points, which is 10,000 grid points, along 10 megahertz bandwidth and 1 millisecond duration. That's exactly Nyquist rate. So everything is okay. It's just we shuffled everything into these coordinates, these radar coordinates, so you need to get used to it. But Nyquist rate continue to exist. So there are at most Nyquist number of signals that you can orthogonally embed in delay Doppler if you are given a specific bandwidth and a specific duration. And that's the Nyquist number. But the bandwidth and the duration define the resolution in delay Doppler. That's how a block diagram of OTFS, if you want to see how simple it is. It's very, very simple. How do you transmit really an OTFS? This is the modulation. That's the actual algorithm. So you start with your QAMs, you start with the bits, you apply some error correcting code, you construct a two-dimensional configuration of QAM symbols. You place them on a grid in delay Doppler, that's what you see in this picture. Okay? And then what do? You take these QAMs and you are applying the discrete ZAC transform. Now the discrete ZAC transform is very simple. After all the math that I told you, that's what you are left with. What you do first, you do FFT, IFFT along Doppler. So this is IFFT of size 20, if you go to the numerology that I just told you. Okay? And then you get a configuration of complex numbers in a domain which is called the delay time domain. And then the next operation in this block diagram is that you interleave in time. You send these time slices one after the other. And that's OTFS. So you take delay Doppler matrix, you apply IFFT along Doppler, and then you interleave. And then you need to filter. These are the pulse. This is the digital signal. Then you need to apply this time frequency filtering. That's OTFS. So the complexity of OTFS is FFT of size 20. All right, for 10,000 symbols. So that's the basic. The FFT of size 20 repeated 500 times. And then there are all kinds of variants of OTFS. You can add a cyclic prefix, and then you will get a variant of OTFS that can be overlaid over an arbitrary over CPO FDM. We will talk about it. All right, I don't know, something failed, but we can ignore that. All right, and then you have the receiver structure. It's just the match operation. So let me summarize everything I told you so far. There are three basic modulation techniques. There is TDMA, which is based on locality and time. There is OFDM, which is based on locality and frequency. And there is another modulation technique, which was completely missed by the academia and the industry until quite recently. And that's OTFS, which is based on locality and delay Doppler, on these signals which are simultaneously localized both in time and in frequency. And I will elaborate on that further. All right. Now let's try to understand the physics. So I'm telling you that the OTFS signals behave as if it is localized both in time and frequency. So let's try to make sense of this statement. Let's try to formalize it. What do I mean by that? So to understand that, we need to understand how the OTFS waveform interacts with the wireless channel. If we understand that, basically we understand the punchline, why OTFS is interesting. Okay. So that's the most important part of my presentation. So the wireless channel consists of reflectors. And reflectors are parameterized by points in delay Doppler. So in this particular example, you see five reflectors. You have three static reflectors. The tower represents the line of sight path, and that's 0, 0. I'm sorry that my 0, 0 is not in the middle. You have a house and you have a building, 0 Doppler. And then you have two mobile reflectors, which have non-zero Doppler shift. So they are moving, okay? And I'm not showing you here the reflectivity gain or the complex gain. Just ignore it. And we want to understand how the OTFS waveform interacts with this reflector. So let me first start with TDMA and OFDM, and then go to OTFS, because this is more familiar. So what happens when you transmit a TDMA pulse? It propagates through the air, bounces off each of the reflectors, and what you get on the other side is a configuration of four echoes displaced in time according to the delay characteristics of the reflector. You have propagation delay. But look at the second echo here. The second echo is in fact a superposition of two reflectors which have the same delay but different Dopplers. The pulse is not localized in frequency, so it cannot separate reflectors along Doppler. So these two reflectors are going to superimpose into a single echo. And this superposition sometimes is going to be constructive, sometimes it's going to be destructive. And as a result, this echo, the amplitude of this echo is going to fluctuate in time. This is called time selectivity. All right? And it's the same thing with OFDM. Now you are transmitting a pulse in frequency. So it means that you are not localized in time, so you cannot separate reflectors along delay. So reflectors which have the same Doppler will superimpose on one another, constructively or destructively, and as a result, you are going to get frequency selective fading. In this particular case, the middle echo is going to fade in frequency. Its amplitude is going to fluctuate. All right? So we see, and this is the main take that I want you to have from this short discussion, and this is very important. Fading is not an intrinsic property of the wireless channel. If you open a book in wireless, they sometimes write, a wireless is a fading channel. This is not true. The channel does not fade. What is fading is the interaction of the channel with a specific waveform. This interaction can fade. The channel is a collection of reflectors. Reflectors do not fade. But the interaction of these reflectors with a specific waveform can fade. And we already understand the mechanism behind fading. The mechanism behind fading is non-locality, either in time or in frequency. Okay? Now look what happened in OTFS. you have the reflectors, and in OTFS, what you are transmitting is a pulse in delay Doppler, a quasi-periodic pulse in delay Doppler. Well, you are transmitting it in the following way. You position the pulse, you convert it to time using the Zach transform, you get this peculiar pulse train, it propagates through the air, bounce off each of the reflectors, arrive to the other side, demodulated back using the inverse Zach transform, and then the question is, what do you get? And I'm not sure, surprising or not, that's what you get. You get a configuration of five echoes displaced both in delay and Doppler according to the delay Doppler characteristics of the reflectors. If the pulses themselves are narrow enough, nothing adds up destructively or constructively. Everything, all the energy passes are separated from one another. And you can collect, if you have the right equalizer, you can coherently combine the energy together in a consistent way, which will apply to all the symbols in the packet. And you mitigated the phenomenon of fading. And this property is called separability. You separate reflectors both along delay and along Doppler, and in this way there is no selectivity. The phenomenon of selectivity completely eliminated. And in this sense, this is the precise mathematical statement by which you say that the OTFS waveform behaves as if it is localized both in time and frequency. Because this kind of behavior, this is exactly what you expect to see from a non-existent pulse in time and frequency. This is how it should behave. And this is how the OTFS waveform behaves. So that's the formal mathematical state. Now there is another interesting property about this channel interaction. And I want to focus on the third point, and this is called invariance. And let me explain what do I mean by that. If you look on this configuration, every echo has a specific amplitude and a specific phase. Now think about TDMA. If you shift in time, the phases and amplitude are going to change. What happens here is very, very different. If you take this pulse that you transmitted and you move it to another point in this box and you look at the corresponding configuration, it's not only going to have the same displacements, it's going to have exactly the same amplitude and phases. Think about what it means. It means that you have 10,000 symbols in a packet which is transmitted over 10 megahertz and 1 millisecond, and in fact you can expand it much further than that, and all the symbols experience exactly the same interaction. It means, mathematically, that you took a time-varying system that can be very attenuated and fading, and you converted it into a coordinate system which rendered it completely static, just two-dimensional. This is a two-dimensional ISI channel, which you can treat using single carrier kind of techniques as a time invariant system. And this is a very powerful thing to be able to do, because basically you converted wireless to something which basically behaved like wired, but in two dimensions. Another important property of this interaction is the number of parameters that you need in order to specify it. The number of parameters is basically the number of reflectors. So this is the sparsest interaction that you can have between the channel and the information. And this will become very important when it comes to complexity. Okay?
So, yes. One question. Traditional, let's call it single carrier modulation.
Mm-hmm.
And when I think about concepts like minimum phase, when you think about equalization,
mm-hmm.
you essentially want to build receivers where the receiver, the feed forward filter,
yeah.
converts the channel into your minimum phase so you can actually cancel the ISI terms,
yes.
decision feedback equalization.
Yes.
What does minimum phase
equalization? That's a good question. That's a good question. Research problem.
Pardon?
That's a research problem.
Research problem.
everything, I'm telling you, as I told you in the beginning, uncharted territory. I can say so much about this thing, but basically doing communication in delay Doppler, it's an open field. So I can answer some of this question, for example, I don't know how to answer. I don't have a precise answer. But there is a meaningful notion of minimum phase in two dimensions in this context. I can guess, but I don't want to. All right, let me now give you a more complete picture of OTFS. It's a universal modulation. In what sense it is universal modulation? In the sense that all other modulations can be viewed as limiting cases of OTFS. So remember the two parameters that I told you in the beginning. Delay and Doppler period, they define a box. You can choose them any way you want. In particular, you have two limits. You can take the delay period to infinity. And when you take the delay period to infinity, what happened to this box? It is compressed, the Doppler goes to zero, and it's compressed into a line. And OTFS becomes TDMA. And you can take the other limit where you take the delay period to zero, and the Doppler period goes to infinity, and this box is compressed into a line again, which is now coincide with frequency, and OTFS becomes becomes OFDM, or FDMA, or FDM. And then you see that in fact, you have a curve which interpolates between OFDM on the one end and TDMA on the other end, and then you have this continuous family of modulations which are joint time and frequency, which interpolate between TDMA and FDMA, and this is the OTFS family. So in fact, OTFS encompasses the two modulations which are in fact corner cases of the OTFS family. And you can see it very clearly by looking at the pulse train. What happened when you take the delay period to infinity? The pulses are getting separated away from one another, further and further away, and in the limit, the tone structure disappears and you are left with a single pulse and that single carrier. And on the other limit, you take the delay period to zero, which means you are compressing the pulses against one another. And in the limit, the pulse structure disappears. And what you get is a continuous tone, which is OFDM. So that's how it works. Another important property of OTFS, which it's important in order to implement it or incorporate it in the context of existing standard or existing multi-carrier system, is that you can implement OTFS as an overlay over an arbitrary multi-carrier modulation. And the way you do it is using a transform called a symplectic Fourier transform, which is a variant of the 2D FFT. And what this symplectic FFT does, it maps a grid in delay Doppler, as we defined, into a reciprocal grid in time frequency. This is where multi-carrier modulation plays the quams. So if you want to transmit an OTFS packet, you place your quams along a grid in delay Doppler, you apply this symplectic FFT, you get a configuration of complex numbers in time frequency, and you transmit them as a sequence of OFDM symbols, and you implemented OTFS. And that's just to give you, this is the two reciprocal grids. I can skip it, but just on the right, you see a time frequency grid with LTE numerology, 50 microseconds is symbol time, 20 kilohertz is subcarrier spacing, 10 megahertz bandwidth, and 1 millisecond TTI. Okay? And then on the left, you see the reciprocal delay Doppler grid, which have the same number of points, but completely different physics. So the delay period is 1 over the subcarrier spacing, which is 50 microseconds. The delay resolution is 1 over the bandwidth, which is 100 nanoseconds. The Doppler period is 1 over the symbol time, which is 20 kilohertz. And the Doppler resolution is 1 over the TTI time, 1 of the observation time, which is 1 kilohertz. So this is how the two grids are related. And they are related by means of the symplectic FFT, which couples the delay variables with the frequency variable by means of FFT and the Doppler variable with the time variable by means of IFFT. And in this way, you can implement OTFS over any multi-carrier modulation that you want. You will get a variant of OTFS. It's not exactly equivalent to the ZAC theoretic one, but it's close enough. Okay, I finished everything I wanted to tell you about OTFS. At this point, everybody in this audience basically understand OTFS as much as I do. Now we can continue. How much time I have left?
About 15 minutes.
So I will talk a little bit about MU-MIMO. And then I can move on and talk a little bit about, okay, we will see how much we get, and then we can talk about other stuff. So I want to really talk a little bit about MU-MIMO and show you some of the performance advantages that OTFS shows in this context. So I'm thinking about the following situation. That's the mental picture that I have. I have a base station. I have a grid of beams, all right, which are serving several users. So every user has a beam, okay? So all the users are sharing the same spectrum. So I'm going to serve all the users over the same spectrum and simultaneously over the same time. So I want to reuse the spectrum. Now in this kind of configuration, if I would have a line of sight condition, if I would live in a vacuum, I will get excellent performance. Because every user will have a beam, the beams are separated enough, very nicely, okay? Excellent performance. The problem starts once you start to add reflectors, moving static. And these reflectors induce a contamination between the beams. Okay, so every user receives his own signal corrupted by interference coming from the transmission of the other beams. And the user itself cannot really mitigate this interference. So it gets a very low SNR. So this interference should be mitigated at the base station using precoding. Okay? And precoding is a kind of technique to cancel the interference using the channel knowledge at the base station. So somehow you are inverting the channel at the base station. And I want to explain to you, again, I'm not going to go too deep, but I want to show you the intrinsic or some hint to the fundamental gain that OTFS can give in the context of nonlinear precoding. So to do that, I'm going to use this diagram. And let's go over this diagram and see what it means. So let's consider the following very simple system. I have a base station with two beams. So I have two transmit layers, and I have two users. All right, so I have two transmit layers, and I have two receive layers. In time frequency, let's start with OFDM. And every layer is a grid in time frequency, because we are talking about OFDM. And let's try to understand, how do you precode in this context? So let's introduce line of sight passes. Let's say that we have two paths. We have a path from beam 1 to user 1, and a line of sight path from beam 2 to user 2. So each one of these passes, in fact, connect transmit layer 1 with receive layer 1, transmit layer 2 with receive layer 2. There is no interaction between these layers because there is no inter-beam interference, so there is no interference, and you get excellent performance. Now let's see what happens if we add a reflector. So there is a reflector in the direction of beam 1, which introduces interference on user 2. So in this propagation diagram, it connects transmit layer 1 from beam 1 to receive layer 2. So this introduces interference, okay, to the signal path. So let's light this point up. This is the interference. So how do a nonlinear precoding works? Well, it goes to this point, to the origin of this path, and distort it in such a way to cancel out the interference. So you precode, and once you precode, you canceled out the interference, and you regain line of sight performance. All right? And everything is good. You precoded in the right way, and you got again line of sight performance. So this you can do. But now let's see what happens if you add another reflector. Now in the direction of beam 2, imposing interference on UE1. So again, in the propagation diagram, this is an edge connecting transmit layer 2 with receive layer 1, imposing interference on this point. Change it to yellow. So what do a precoder does? Well, it looks, well, I have interference there. You go back to transmit layer 1 and you precode this point. You precode it so that to cancel the interference at the receiver. Once you do it, the interference disappears. But look, you precode at this point, so you change the interference on this point. So you need to go back now to transmit layer 2 and precode it again. You got a vicious cycle. This precoding is not good anymore. So you got this vicious cycle. You cannot precode in a consistent manner so that to cancel all the interference. Because, why? Because somehow you cannot, on a tone by tone basis, you cannot separate the interference passes from the line of sight passes. Now let's look what happened with OTFS. Let's do the same drill, but now in delay Doppler. So again, I have the line of sight. These are the passes. Now these are delay Doppler coordinates. Okay, line of sight performance, everything is good. Now let's add a reflector. Inducing interference on UE2. This is represented by an edge connecting transmit layer 1, but now it's going to impose interference on a different point in receive layer 2 because you have a different propagation delay and a different Doppler. So the interference is now imposed on a different point, not on the same point. And if you add another reflector, it will introduce interference again on another point. And the cycle disappears. So there is no cycles in the propagation graph. And because there are no cycles, you have a chance to cancel out in a consistent manner all the interference. And that's kind of an intuition of where a gain in precoding can come from. And I'm going to show you the gain. Simulation show gain. So basically, what I'm trying to hint is that delay Doppler coordinates allows you to convert an arbitrary interference channel to a line of sight channel. So it gives you a method, which is, by the way, low complexity. You don't need to invert matrices there. It gives you a method using clever signal processing to convert any interference channel into a line of sight channel. All right? And these are the performance gains that you see in simulations for this particular symmetric configuration of two layers, two UEs, and these two reflectors. So these are called CDFs. So for every SNR on the x-axis, you are actually building a random assemble of random channels of this geometry. And you are computing, you are doing Tomlinson-Arashima precoding using OTFS. This is this type of precoding that I showed you. And Tomlinson-Arashima precoding using OFDM. And you are measuring the residual SNR. What the SNR that the precoded user is getting. And you are building a statistics of these SNRs. And you draw the histograms. And from the histogram, you get the cumulative distribution functions. And that's what you get. So the blue graph is OTFS. That's a typical SNR that the user gets. The red graph is OFDM with an optimal, the best that we could program. Regularized, zero forcing, THP, precoder for OFDM. And you see that for 10% of the user, with probability of 10%, you see something like 5.7 dB gain. Between Tomlinson-Arashima and delay Doppler, which take advantage of the fact that it is cycle-free propagation graph, compared to Tomlinson-Arashima time frequency precoding. That's the gain in 10%. When you go to 1% probability, it grows to 9.1 dB for this very simple channel. And then the yellow graph, that's the standard. That's what people are going to, that's what people envision using linear precoding. So you see 10 dB, 12 dB gap. It's not very good performance. That's linear precoder for OFDM. Now, I want to add something more. There is another gain that OTFS gives you in the context of precoding. So what this graph shows you is the average residual interference. So what it shows you that using delay Doppler precoding, you can get on average lower residual interference. You cancel more interference. But there is another problem with OFDM, and it is the following. If you are a user in OFDM, so you experience a certain average interference. You have 500 tones, you look at the interference on every tone, you have certain average interference, which is 5 to 6 dB greater than OTFS. But there is another problem. If you look at this interference from tone to tone, you see it's going to fluctuate a lot. for certain tones it's going to be low, for certain tones it's going to be high. On average it's going to be something, but it's going to fluctuate a lot around this average. This is because of the selectivity of the channel. Now this is a problem because you don't know how it fluctuates. You as a receiver, you don't know what is the interference per tone. You need to assume the average. So basically your encoder, your decoder, operates under unknown colored noise with huge fluctuations. And this, then the LLRs are not correct, and this causes another degradation in performance. This is very different than equalization in fading channels, where you have channel state information and you can actually encode them into the LLRs. Here you have unknown level of interference, that you only know its average. All right? Now contrast it with OTFS, where you don't have selectivity at all, and the interference by definition is going to be the same for all the resource elements. So it's not only going to be higher on the average, it's going to be constant, which means that you can get this type of performance. Now, this was theory. Now let me tell you something. Well, I come from a company, so it's not enough to show slides. So you have to build something. And that's what Cohere built. It built a radio which implements all this technology that I just told you. And this is a field trial done 2 months ago in the Telefonica campus in Madrid, as part of a project called the Fivetonic something. Anyhow, we did two trials in this demonstration. It's very similar to what I showed you. So we have one, on the left you see a 90 degree sector. You have a base station with 8 antennas. Each antenna is double polarization, serving 8 UEs in a 90 degree sector. Every UE or every user have double polarization antenna. Okay? So this is the configuration on the left. And the UEs are in different ranges, in different distances. And on the right, you see even a more interesting configuration. You see a 45-degree sector. And the UEs appear in pairs. And every pair is only 2 to 3 meters apart. And they are being served now, not by a single base station, but by two base stations, which are distanced apart, and collaborate in a Cloud RAN fashion, if you want, in order to create this additional angular resolution. And these are the results. And by the way, to show you, this is the environment. So this is a very challenging environment. This campus basically behaves like a resonant chamber. It's glass building surrounding a courtyard of 300 meters or so. When you look at the delay spread of the channel, it is something like 6 to 7 microseconds. I have pictures. It's a huge delay spread because the wave propagates, bounce off back and forth from the glass windows. It's a crazy environment, really a resonant chamber. And these are the results that we get. So you see on the right the results that you get for the 90 degree sector. So we are transmitting 8 users, we are reusing the spectrum 16 times. There are 16 layers over the air. There are 8 users. Every user is getting 2 streams. Okay? And you see the QAMs. QAM 64, QAM 32, 2 layers are QAM 16. The overall raw spectral efficiency for 90 degree sector is 84 bits per second per hertz. Per 90 degree sector. This is equivalent to 336 bits per second per hertz per cell. 336 bits per second per hertz per cell. What the industry is advertising today, it's 10, something like that. Now, this is raw throughput. You have to take 70% of that to take into account all the overheads. All right? Look at the coupling matrix. This is the blue and the yellow. So every column in this diagram represent a user, and the rows represent receive antennas in different beams. So if it would be complete line of sight, all the energy would be on the diagonal. Because every user is going to be received only by its own beam. But because there is so much reflections, you see that the energy from a single user in a specific direction actually contaminate all the beams. And this just to show you how difficult is this environment. And on the left, you see the 45 degree. So the 45 degree, you get 72 bits per second per hertz, per 45 degree. 72 bits per second per hertz per 45 degree, this translates, I'm a bit embarrassed to say the number, to 576 bits per second per hertz per cell. 576 bits per second per hertz per cell, that's a lot. And then again, you see the QAMs, and again, you can look at the coupling matrix. It's very, the energy is spread all around. Okay, that's what I wanted to tell you about MU-MIMO. I can talk a little bit about other propagation aspects if we have time, or we can talk directly on some research problems and things like that.
Why don't we do that?
Let's jump
into the interesting.
Okay, so just to tell you very quickly, there are link budget advantages in OTFS. Very quickly, let me tell you, the same way you can do DFT spread OFDM, where you take a small piece of band and you do DFT, and in this way get PAPR of single carrier, you can do the same thing with delay Doppler. You take a small band of Doppler, you do DFT spread over this small band, and you get DFT spread OTFS, which give you PAPR of single carrier, but at the same time, it's a wide band modulation, extract the full diversity. So you get this kind of, you combine these performance gains, and this translates again to performance gain because you combine PAPR with diversity, something which DFT spread OFDM does not do. You are resilient to narrow band interference because basically you are spread spectrum. OTFS is spread spectrum. You can think about it, for example, every delay Doppler grid point is spread over the full time frequency grid. So it's a kind of a CDMA in time frequency. Okay, but a very special type of CDMA. Why CDMA? Okay, let me make a guess. Why CDMA was abandoned? Okay, probably I will say I will be wrong, but let me make a guess, a wild guess. Because it couldn't extract capacity. This is one of the problems with CDMA. It is interference limited. But it has other advantages. It is a good modulation. So you can think about OTFS from a CDMA point of view. It's a variant of CDMA which can extract capacity. So you get, so in particular, you are resilient to this type of narrow band interference.
Wasn't it like the power control issues with the CDMA?
There were many problems, yes. But one of the problems was that CDMA to device an equalizer for CDMA that extract capacity, it's a complicated task. It's advantage under mobility, again, it's a diversity gain. Remember, the performance of OTFS is directly correlated to the total energy of the reflectors and not to the way this energy is distributed among the reflectors because everything is separated. So you get very predictable performance. What is important is that you have enough reflectors, that you have enough energy. You don't care anymore about these local fadings. And again, you can see this kind of... So for mobility, in fact, you can find now a lot of publications about resilience to Doppler, which are done by different people. So this kind of aspect of OTFS is being researched today. Another interesting thing about OTFS, there is no ICI. ICI is a pathology of multicarrier modulation. When you operate in delay Doppler, ICI does not exist. It's not a phenomenon which you have to care about. So in fact, what you see here is that OTFS with the numerology of 15 kilohertz beat OFDM with numerology of 60 kilohertz, just because of this resilience to ICI. Again, something to research. Everything I'm telling you, it's preliminary. It's just, you can run with it. Okay, research topics. I will have to look at the whiteboard because my eyesight is not good enough to. Okay, let me try. Basically everything. Everything is a legitimate research topic about OTFS. It's an uncharted territory. You know, I'm working on it for 10 years, but really, and with some, of course, with the help of many, many people, but I'm a single person and I'm not even a communication engineer. And to tell you the truth, I know that I'm only touching the tip of the iceberg of every topic. I touch and I have to move on. So every topic is a legitimate research topic that you can dig in and say something intelligent about it. On the most general level, the whole aspect of delay Doppler signal processing, or doing signal processing in the delay Doppler representation is a legitimate research topic. How do you do filtering? How do you do sampling? How do you do filter banks? How do you do all these things that you used to do in time or frequency? Do it in delay Doppler. Learn how to think in delay Doppler. Because once you teach yourself how to think in delay Doppler, you will never want to go back to time and frequency because you will not need them anymore. It combines the two. All right? So, but you need to teach this. If you are being, you think that frequency is a very simple thing. Everybody accepts frequency as, you know, as a kind of a common knowledge. Well, if you think a little bit about frequency, it's not so simple. It's just that you are used to it. Yes, they taught you about it for so many years. And Fourier invented it, I don't know how many hundreds of years ago, so you feel comfortable with it. But it's not because it is simple, it's just because you feel comfortable with it. So it's the same with delay Doppler. You need to become comfortable with delay Doppler, and then it will become just like Fourier. And the Zach transform becomes your Fourier transform. So massive MIMO in OTFS, all these aspects of delay Doppler precoding. This is research topic. How do you do delay? How do you really precode? What precode our complexity and performance? Theoretical analysis of delay Doppler precoding compared to time frequency precoding, nonlinear precoding. Very important question. No work is done on that. Can you actually prove the delay Doppler precoding? Proof means not giving you some stupid diagram that I gave you, but real proof. The delay Doppler precoding is actually fundamentally better than time frequency precoding, and if this is true, when? Okay? And then something very interesting, I think, and again, this is something that Cohere is trying to do, is this precoding techniques where you cancel out the interference of longer propagation delays, this extend beyond a single cell. This extends to a multi-cell interference mitigation. Because when you have a multi-cell system, different cells interact with one another and contaminate one another. And the way you can cancel out this interference is by canceling out the longer propagation delays. Always the interference have longer propagation. And this can be detected and canceled out in the delay Doppler coordinates. So it becomes a very efficient tool to design cloud run based multi-cell interference mitigation system. Of course, OTFS for high mobility, it's a topic. It's already being researched, but on it's just the beginning. So performance in the presence of high delay and Doppler spread, performance in the presence of ICI, as I told you, OTFS is basically oblivious to ICI. Performance in the presence of interference, these are all propagation attributes. DFT spread OTFS, that's a new modulation technique. It's a DFT spread. It's the OTFS variant of DFT spread. That's a fascinating modulation because it's a modulation which combines spreading with low PAPR. If you think about it, it's not so easy to do. Both to spread, but keep the PAPR of single carrier and do it in a meaningful way. So I think it's a very interesting modulation to investigate. OTFS NOMA. Power multiplexing in delay Doppler. That's basically an uncharted territory. Everything there, I think, is interesting. OTFS for millimeter wave communication. Well, the modulation can apply to any carrier. All the work of Cohere so far was focused on sub-6, any other band. When you go to millimeter wave, many things are accentuated. In millimeter wave, for example, Doppler, if you don't have such a narrow beam, this is a very delicate thing. But Doppler become accentuated because Doppler is linear with the carrier frequency. So Doppler, if you have a walking velocity, becomes very high Doppler. Phase noise is very high Doppler. So all these aspects should be investigated in delay Doppler because maybe OTFS is the optimal modulation for millimeter wave. Clearly, people understand that OFDM have a lot of problems with millimeter wave. This inter-carrier interference is a big trouble because what they do today in the standard, they take the subcarrier spacing and they extend it from 20 kilohertz to 400 kilohertz just to mitigate the phase noise. But when you extend to 400 kilohertz, you shrink the symbol time to, I don't know, to nothing proportionally. And if the delay spread doesn't change, only the CP will kill all your capacity. You need to shrink the CP proportionally, but this is a very risky thing to do. But OTFS does not need a CP. OTFS is CP, is CP-free modulation. So all these things can be thought through in delay Doppler, and there is something there, I'm almost sure. OTFS is a unifying framework for radar and communication. This I know that is being contemplated here. So really OTFS at the same time of being a communication technique is a state-of-the-art radar. You saw it. Basically the channel structure that you measure is a precise delay Doppler representation of your environment. So you can actually sense, you can radar the image, you can radar the environment and at the same time communicate information through the environment. Passive radar. You can communicate through satellite and at the same time detect, I don't know, all these hiding planes flying around. So it opens the gate to so many different things. So all these location-based things. So really OTFS, once you appreciate it, you start to think about radar in the language of OTFS. Because really, if you open a book in radar, I try to do it, and I close it very quickly. It's a very difficult subject because it is difficult mainly because it lacks the foundations that communication has. Gabor built the mathematical foundations of communication, which is all these multi-carrier filter banks and all this time frequency. This is why communication theory is easy to learn, quote unquote, because you have something formal, something well-defined, and everything else you can derive. Radar is not exactly like that. There is a lot of art in radar. There is a lot of monkey business. Once you think about radar using the Zach transform, basically it becomes mathematically defined. That's it. You can start to play with it the same way you play with communication. And in fact, you already understand that it is Fourier dual to communication because there is symplectic Fourier duality between delay Doppler, which is radar, and time frequency, which is Gabor communication. So it gives you, you can understand radar very, very well thinking in terms of this formalism. And finally, hardware impairments, phase noise, IQ imbalance. I understand nothing about these things, but I had to write them. but I think they are worth. But really, the first statement is the most important statement. Just pick a subject. Pick a subject, and you throw a stone, and whatever it hit, you have a paper. So that's basically the rule. It's so easy. I think I will stop here.
Any questions?
So I'm immediately thinking about how do I construct a statistical version of this, right? So in some ways, if the delay Doppler is deterministic,
yes,
I can do this. Now if I add randomness to that.
Where do you want to add randomness? To the channel?
For the fun part of your goal.
Yes.
Then you think about the signals as random possibilities,
mm-hmm.
and then you do statistical.
That's true.
So if I just do that lazy way of just thinking, what would be the equivalent? Like, what would be the equivalent?
So really,
autocorrelation process.
Oh, good. Autocorrelation. Good. Nice question. So autocorrelation. So remember the. Yes. So basically the. Okay, I will give you an answer. It will be a cheat, but a good cheat. But remember, I will go back to the slide. I don't have, well, remember this slide. This slide, I think, is very important. Okay, it's not important. I will just say it. So the autocorrelation in time is done using convolution. That's the basic operation. You have the operation of convolution. That's one way to. So the basic operation that you can use in the replacement of this convolution is what is called quasi-convolution. Okay? So basically, you can actually define everything using this operation of quasi-convolution. It's more sophisticated. I will tell you, for example, one thing which for me is an open problem. I don't know how to solve it. So for example, one basic thing that you do in classical communication is you split the filters. You have a transmit filter and you have a receive filter and they are square root Nyquist. namely the power, the multiplication of them becomes Nyquist. Now, in delay Doppler, the filter acts by some multiplication or convolution. Convolution in time become Nyquist, or multiplication in frequency become Nyquist. In, as I told you, a filter in delay Doppler acts by quasi-convolution, okay? And if you have consecutive filters, they act by consecutive quasi-convolution. So filters now are functions of two variables of delay Doppler, arbitrary functions. And if you want to compose two filters, you have to apply quasi-convolution between them. What does it mean to be square root Nyquist in this context? Because quasi-convolution is not a commutative operation. It's not, it's more sophisticated operation than convolution. So let's say that you have a filter and you want to compute the square root with respect to quasi-convolution. I don't know how to do it. I think it's a very important question. So these are on the I'm stuck already on this level. That you need to, yeah, there are certain things that you do all the time in classical theory. I don't know how to do them in this more general context. But okay, I don't know if I answered exactly your question, but I gave you, okay, yes. That's a very good question. So first of all, in general, if you are willing to invest enough complexity, OTFS is always better. Namely, at trivial channels, it will behave like any other orthogonal. Let's start with the baseline. Trivial channel, OTFS will behave like any other orthogonal modulation. As you start to add impairments and you have the right receiver and transmitter, OTFS will start to develop a certain gap. Now, but you can dig deeper into this question. You can ask, okay, if I'm starting to look at performance complexity trade-off, this is, I think, a very important curve. Not only performance, but performance complexity, this Pareto curve. Where does OTFS, how the Pareto curve of OTFS compare to the Pareto curve of OFDM? So I claim there is an inflection point. I claim that if you look at SISO, for example, OFDM has better complexity than OTFS. Because no equalization, or very simple equalization. But as you go to higher order MIMO, there is an inflection point. And suddenly you would prefer to go to delay Doppler than to work in time frequency, and I will explain why. Let's say that you want to invert a 100 by 100 matrix. You are serving 100 users. You want to reuse the spectrum 100 times. In OFDM, it means that every tone has a 100 by 100 matrix. And because the channel is selective, for every tone, it's going to be a different matrix. So if you have 10 megahertz and 1 millisecond, you will have to invert 10,000 100 by 100 matrices. Go and buy now 900 GPUs to do it. It's become a formidable task. On the contrast, in delay Doppler, grant you for a particular symbol, the interaction is more complicated because this I psi, two dimensional. But it's the same interaction for all the symbols. And if you do the right signal processing, it should be non-linear signal processing. It boils down to an inversion of a single matrix for all the 10,000 symbols. It's going to be a slightly more complicated matrix. But I think this inflection point is interesting. Because at a certain point, you would like to tailor your complexity to the number of reflectors and not to the MIMO order. And the complexity of OTFS is tailored, the basic parameters which govern the complexity is the number of reflectors. So I think this is an interesting thing to understand, this complexity performance trade-off. And it will compare in a non-trivial manner. Yes.
So while you implement OTFS, what are the main challenges that you face, that you should consider, while you implement OTFS?
What are the main challenges that you get? The first challenge that you need to think in delay Doppler. In the beginning, your mind don't want to do it. So the first thing, your mind reject it. I don't want to do it. So that's the first. Once you overcome that, if you find the topic fascinating enough, you teach yourself to think in delay Doppler. As you saw, the modulation itself is trivial. Operation-wise, it's trivial. It's just FFT along one dimension and then time interleaving and then maybe filtering. The filtering is important, so I don't want to dismiss it. The next challenge, which I think you will find from what I discussed and I hear it from many parties, and I also get emails, so I have to answer every week or so an email from different Chinese university or things like that. OTFS with linear signal processing does not give you any gain. You need to do nonlinear signal processing. It's just part of the DNA of this modulation. Nonlinear signal processing is a dying art because of OFDM. So you need to teach yourself again this fundamental, fascinating, very interesting structures of decision feedback equalization and all of that. These are the Tomlinson Arashima, which is decision feedback in a transmitter. You need to revive this beautiful science of signal processing, which basically disappeared once OFDM was introduced. You need to bring back into the picture non-linear signal processing, and this will be the main. Once you overcome this difficulty, the sky is the limit. Yes. The same sampling, because the sampling is defined by the bandwidth.
But to realize the very narrow pulses, which OFDM doesn't have, do you have to oversample?
Oh, you're asking me a good question. Probably you have to oversample, yes. But I will take this question. If these questions about our implementation, I will direct to other experts. But you need to oversample. You need to oversample, probably, yes. But. But so I'm not equipped to answer your question. I don't want to answer your question and lead you in the wrong direction. So we can take this question offline and try to ask make it good better. Yes. Yes.
There are many open problems under the in network information theory under interference channel. Will this be helpful to solve the channel capacity region problems?
You are asking me. It's not, it's related, but I try to read works on this network from information theory. You know, people are, there is a guy in Austin called Francois Bacelli that also is doing very serious math around it. So very clever people are thinking about. I'm not able to understand this work. I have to admit. For me, what is interesting about OTFS is the fact that I can see a constructive algorithm to mitigate all the interference.
But you're dealing interference like you're orthogonalized, right?
I'm canceling out the interference. I'm not orthogonal. I'm not rejecting it using filters. I'm not inverting anything. I'm subtracting it. I'm subtracting it because I can separate the interference due to its longer propagation delay and Doppler. Can. And I can envision, again, I can envision how I can design a combination. I can build this big propagation graph of my full network. There is a huge propagation graph. It's a huge combinatorial structure. Okay, I showed you the propagation graph of a 2x2 MU-MIMO system, but this propagation graph can be extended to a full multi-cell system, and I can envision an algorithm, kind of a random walk on this graph, which like a LDPC decoder, you know, which goes and cancel out the interference, very low complexity, and it will, to some extent, will work. And I think this is very interesting. If I would have my time now, I would sit down and try to, you know, to play with this.
I don't understand this fully, whether I can answer this, but what you would have to show is that the Tomlinson Arashima precoder, in combination with channel coding, let's say the simple 2x2 case, you know, is able to actually achieve capacity for the, you know, two-user system. I think if you can do that, that would be interesting.
I have another angle on that, mm-hmm. another angle on that, which I want to mention. Again, from what I thought about this, at least ideologically, quite a lot. So, what is the criterion of a MU-MIMO? So I try to think about it a lot because I'm really interested in the performance complexity trade-off. Now, if my criterion is to achieve capacity, my complexity is going to be huge. There will be huge complexity. Now, in OTFS, I can design a different criterion which is impossible to formulate in OFDM. I can design a criterion which I can reach using low amount of complexity, and it still will give me excellent performance. And the criterion is, I want to achieve line of sight performance. It's a different criterion than achieving capacity. I want to design a precoded system which is able to cancel out all the interference and leave me only with the line of sight path. Let's say that there is always a line of sight path. So what I want to do is to cancel out all the line of sight propagation path and leave only the line of sight path. This is not capacity, because I'm putting some energy on the table. This is not capacity, but this kind of criterion is interesting because it lends itself in the OTFS paradigm to a very efficient precoding technique. No matrix inversion, just this cancellation. And this is impossible to do in OFDM. I don't see how to do it in OFDM. How to even formulate this condition in OFDM, because the line of sight and the no line of sight on a tone, they just superimpose on one another. You cannot separate them. So you can reach capacity probably in OFDM, but you cannot formulate these intermediate objectives, which I think in terms of capacity complexity trade-off are more interesting. And also for the system design, by the way. If you want to design a system, I tell you, achieving line of sight performance is aligned with the system design. You can design a system around this thing. Very predictable system. It's more difficult for me to understand how do you design a system along capacity. But,
yeah.
Yes. Yes.
If we were doing delay-based interference cancellations, right? You could think of what MIMO, OFDM doesn't do it, but you could have ideally implemented a delay-based interference cancellation.
How do you do it? Because the QAMs are not in delay.
No, no, you basically do DFE equalization for OFDM as well, right? And you do standard equalization of OFDM.
No, but you do DFE among the streams. You don't do DFE along delays in OFDM. You cannot. You will have to explain to me how do you do in OFDM, how do you subtract?
Think of what you're doing, the subtraction, but if I mimic the right amount of delay, then I could have canceled in the layer approach, right? If I could perfectly mimic that. So
I will need to, okay, continue.
So my thought process and what I'm trying to understand here is perhaps from now one dimension, right, of delay doing
yeah.
interference cancellation, you're going to the second dimension Doppler, which is allowing you to separate them better.
Yes.
And therefore, interference cancellation is doing better.
Yes, that's true.
So
that's what I'm trying to hint.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes. And I would like to understand what you are saying about them. I think it's interesting to me.
So a few more questions, please.
Yes. Okay, you have to repeat again. What was the question? Yes, please.
So, you know, as we move into the world of delay Doppler,
yes.
Do the front ends, which to some extent the question that Jinyu asked, A2D, how oversampling, and you're asking questions like the RF. Do we have to fundamentally rethink as radio engineers, do you have to think about how we are to change the transmitters and receivers, RF implementations?
I understand. Okay, I will give
is
you...
That, is that the right question?
Yes.
Okay, I will give you my... As I told you, there are two implementations of OTFS which are not completely equivalent. One is more correct than the other. The correct implementation is using the ZAC transform. And there, the answer to your question might be yes. You need to think again. Maybe you won't have to change anything, but at least you might have to think again about everything. But then there is the other implementation, which is slightly weaker version of OTFS, which implement it as a spreading technique over multicarrier. And then you can use the front end of your multicarrier modulation, because what OTFS really is a 2D FFT over OFDM, over multicarrier modulation. So you don't need to change anything on the front end of OFDM. Yes, yes, you can carry the cyclic prefix of OFDM, you can do everything, yeah. The subtle difference, when you model OTFS over OFDM, you need to carry the prefix. Otherwise, OFDM will collapse together with OFDM. But when you model OTFS only using the ZAC, it doesn't need a cyclic prefix, which is, I think, interesting.
So the question in that particular case,
yeah.
If you want to go on, what are the, if you essentially keep the front ends, the all the way through the standard demodulation techniques
mm-hmm.
of OFDM the same
yes.
as before,
yes.
What are you gaining? What do you give up? Do you give up any of these?
You give up resilience. You are going to suffer many of the illnesses
of OFDM.
For example, if the CP is not going to be long enough,
mm-hmm.
you are going to drown together. Yes,
mm-hmm.
it's going to carry it with you.
Mm-hmm.
So, but you gain the diversity, and you gain the non-linear. If you gain all many of the attributes you gain, but some of the resilience you lose.
So the fading is in some sense continuous, you know, it's almost like they're infinite.
Okay.
So how does that?
Again, eventually I see the fading on the digital level. So once I go through the whole the cycle of my communication system, I start from a sampled signal in delay Doppler, and I end up with a sampled signal in delay Doppler, and these two signals are related by some channel relation or by some and this channel relation is what this channel relation which has a certain structure in OTFS which admits no fading so
but that is because the channel representation is modeled by these reflectors. I guess this question is
yes.
for other frequency
you are saying that there are other effects they will manifest themselves as impairments or as perturbations on this very ideal picture.
Yeah, which goes back to your question, Tara, on how do we introduce randomness into the thought
yes.
process?
Yes. Because in some ways, this is a good, if you take the classic DSP, good for LTI, for linear time invariant systems,
yeah.
this is very good for
non-linear, yeah.
delay-Doppler invariant systems, right?
This is a kind of time-varying
yeah.
linear
varying,
system. When viewed in delay-Doppler, they become, in a sense, invariant.
But your delay-Doppler is invariant
I think
yes.
in a sense over
yeah.
the time and
yeah.
the bandwidth
yeah.
that you're
yeah.
considering,
yes.
right? And if you now start perturbing that,
yeah.
also
so the question that goes is we understand deterministic signal processing here, and then there is the language of statistical signal processing that this could carry over to, and the question is, can we model all the communication systems we'll deal with normally as a, let us call it a quasi-static, that is, you can just use training sequences on some small periodic basis and treat it as a quasi-static phenomenon of delay Doppler in that small duration, or do you have to model all these perturbations and think of things as happening random? Those are all things that we will learn over time.
Can I say something? And now I'm quoting Andy Molish. Right, because he's working with Cohere, and well, after hearing him enough, I can at least repeat certain things that he says. So he's saying that one of the interesting things about delay Doppler is that it changes the concept of coherence time. So basically, when you do statistical signal processing, your statistical signal processing really try to model your coherence time, the fact that things are changing very, very quickly. So you model it statistically. Yes, the channel part. The channel.
But the signal itself, because I'm talking to you about something that you don't know,
yeah.
it also is random, and that you cannot really model it as coherent.
Yes.
Time. That's the information rate that I'm conveying to you.
Yes, okay, no.
That's what I was talking about.
All right, but about the channel, he's saying that really the coherence time now is the coherence time of the geometry of the reflectors.
Exactly.
So it pushed the kind of all these notions of Riley fading and all of that, they are pushed to a completely different time scale.
Most probably in this model is the randomness in your mobility model, right? Because if the speed is fixed, your Doppler is fixed. But
yeah.
if I'm changing my
yeah.
speed, that's
yeah.
where the randomness, the easiest
yeah.
place the randomness will show.
Yeah.
There is a new definition now we need, which is stationarity, and it has to be defined on delay Doppler.
agree. Yeah, I agree with that. That's.
But first, we have to define what is the delay Doppler stochastic process, right?
So,
before
that's
we even
have to.
Driven by actually the measurements these do, and should be in nature's representation instead of being defining a process.
No, but you can model. You can actually, but eventually you want to come up with the model.
In order to model, you first need to measure.
You want to measure. I agree. I agree. First thing, you know, first exercise with OTFS is measure channels. Measure, 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 and look at them enough. Yeah.
Okay. This is, any other questions? It's a, yeah, please go ahead.
Wow, I'm a lot of questions.
Yeah, sorry about that.
No, it's a pleasure. Very good question. So, all right. Channel. I have a full lecture about channels. I think it's basically it's a very interesting topic. But so there are two aspects to treat channel. So one aspect is to actually measure the channel in delay Doppler. So how do it? You put a pilot in delay Doppler with the data. So you put a delta function in delay Doppler, and you put an empty space over this delta function, and the empty space is proportional to the delay spread and Doppler spread of the channel. And then you transmit this structure through the air. And what you're going to get in the receiver is this delta convolved with the delay Doppler impulse response. So, but as I told you, this delay Doppler impulse response is going to be the same for all the other symbols in the packet. So you measure it over this delta, and that's it, and you use it. That's a very robust estimation. They're very robust, and there are papers now about it. I don't think it's the most efficient one. But that's the most natural way to use delay Doppler for channel estimation. And the nice thing about it, you don't need to interpolate. You don't need to do anything. You measure the channel, and literally this is the channel which applied to all the symbols, and it will be good for delay, any Doppler, any delay, it will work always. So it can give you a very robust approach for channel estimation. Then there is another way, which I think is also very interesting. So you're using delay Doppler not to measure the channel, but to model the channel. Namely, you're building a model of the channel, which means you are learning the geometry of the reflector. You don't acquire the phases of the reflector. You only model the geometry of the reflector, which means the delay Doppler characteristic and the propagation loss, if you wish, because these are the attributes of the channel which change very slowly. You model them. That's a process, and once you model them and you have this compact model of the channel, you can acquire it any way you want. You can acquire it using pilots in time frequency, you can acquire it using pilots in delay Doppler, and you don't need a lot of measurements because the model is already reduced the channel to 15 parameters. And that gives you flexibility, much bigger flexibility. But It's more sophisticated.
But is it fair to say this is also an open research problem? Nice
that's problem. That's yeah. For me, I think going into this delay Doppler channel models and use them in order to sense the channel efficiently, in order to predict the channel long into the future, long into adjacent band, that's what Cohere is doing. And I cannot. It's only the tip of the iceberg. It's like this can open the gate to massive. This is the gate for real 5G. If you think about 5G, what is the main obstruction to 5G? The main obstruction to what 5G is promising, if you think about it, is really channel processing. Because if you really want to do massive spectral reuse and cloud run and all these things that 5G is promising, you need to acquire thousands of channels. And you need to acquire them over the full band. How do you do it without eating all your capacity? So clearly this delay Doppler modeling of the channel and using it in order to make channel processing more efficient, that's an important, that's the way to go, I think.
Let's thank you once more for the wonderful talk and discussion. I think it's very fascinating. It would really make us think, and hopefully we'll span some nice research work here.
Great.